This is Nathan Morris with Good Medicine. And I wanted to talk about today the role of immune system and immune system function and how that really plays a key role in everything that relates to disease. I think the great thing about functional medicine is the connection of all things together to create health. And I think immune system is pretty much the key player in all disease processes that I look at, and especially in chronic issues that when my patients come in to see me, I need to understand how the immune system is being affected. And today I'll talk about the things that are affecting the immune system, and then how do we go about making changes, everyday changes. It's not real complicated like so many things in functional medicine. It really does come down to some very basic tenets that we can use to create good immune health. And by creating good immune health, we can affect a lot of diseases that seem to be disconnected and not these diseases are that we tend to think of as inevitable, which are really not. So the first part of the immune system, if you can see my picture here, there's the immune system, which really, when we're talking about the immune system and immune system dysfunction, we're really talking about whether the immune system is working where it's recognizing things that should be gotten rid of by the body, or is it in a state of constant surveillance where it's overactive, and that leads to a state of inflammation. And inflammation is great when it's working. If we get a flu virus or we get an infection such as Lyme disease, we really want that surveillance to see those things and create a reaction that helps us get rid of it. So immune system is a double-edged sword. The problem is a lot of us are being cut by this sword when that state goes from doing its job of getting rid of the infection and goes into a chronic inflammation state. So immune system is the cause of inflammation. So when we look at inflammation, we're really talking about a lot of disease processes. So immune equals inflammation when it is in a overactive state. And the number one place that we have to start, no matter who you are and what disease process you may be dealing with, you've got to start with the GI tract. This is probably the one tenet in functional medicine that is emphasized over and over to us as practitioners. And I think it's very important that we teach our patients, where does the GI system fit into this immune system function? And I think this is something that's not put together. We've shown that the GI system is really related to a lot of diseases, and now they're finding, which we've been talking about for years in the functional medicine model, what role even the bacteria play. And the reason that we're finding that if we could change the bacteria in the gut, we've seen improvement in autism, and there's a big relation there, is because the GI system is where about 99% of our immune function is being processed. So if you think about it, we have almost 60 to 70% of our immune system sitting in our gut. And why is that? Because we may cut ourselves once every blue moon, once a month or so, and you need to be able to take care of those bacteria you know, in your skin or what you breathe in. But what we eat is really where the immune system is deciding what's good and bad. So if we're eating things that our immune system recognizes as not being recognizable or something that's inflammatory, so when we eat things such as gluten and dairy, which is like all my patients know that when I first see them, that's two of the things I take them off of immediately because I want to affect the immune system. And the reason is that gluten, over the years, has become more dominant in our diets, but we're also making our foods differently, where the gluten is not being broken down by the process of making bread. We used to let bread rise 12 hours. Most of the gluten was broken down by those bacteria. And the same goes with dairy. Dairy is now homogenized, pasteurized, and it's making these small particles that the immune system doesn't recognize. And gluten is one of those things that is the hardest to digest proteins in the body. And we're exposing, and it automatically causes our immune system to be exposed to particles because it opens up gaps in our intestine. Gluten just does that. Even in rats that have never been exposed to it or fed gluten, then they create these large gaps in their small intestine that allows particles to come in, and our immune system does its job. And it recognizes things as being foreign. And so by the process of hybridization of wheat, we've increased our gluten content almost 800 to 900% in our wheat. We're not allowing that gluten to be broken down by bacteria. So now we have a real source of inflammation starting in the GI tract. And a lot of times when people come to me and they say, well, I have allergies. And this is the season where we have allergies. So one of the things that the immune system sees and creates is allergies. And allergies to me, I don't really see people as having allergies to cat and dog dander or pollen. I see it more, we should see allergies as more of a overreaction of the immune system. And so a lot of times the first thing I do is say, well, let's talk about your diet. And when I remove certain foods, like myself, I remove gluten and dairy, and I was on 5 different medications for whether it was an inhaler, it was an antihistamine, it was a nasal steroid, just to control my allergies. And luckily, by changing my diet, and for a lot of people, by taking probiotics, which is one of the supplements that I highly recommend, is probiotics. Because probiotics are good bacteria that go into the gut, and guess what? Those probiotics affect the immune system. And so by doing probiotics, by removing things like gluten and dairy, a lot of times the things that we're reacting to in the environment are not seen as being something that needs to be reacted to. It's a part of our natural environment, and we're not overreacting. So we want to do the things that help our immune system not overreact. So it's not about being on allergy shots. It's about understanding why our immune system is overreacting. Another thing that we see where we can apply leverage is at the GI tract when we look at things like arthritis. So arthritis is one of those things that everybody tends to think of. Okay, I've got arthritis, my mom had arthritis, my grandmother had arthritis, and the issue with arthritis is that it's not that your joints, arthritis is by definition inflammation of the joint, itis being inflammation, arth being the joint, and so when we look at inflammation of the joint, none of us have perfect joints after a while, we use them. And once again, it's getting the immune system not to overreact to something that's not perfect. And so that's why when we take steroids, arthritis gets better. It dampens the immune system. And the immune system is attacking a joint that it thinks is not perfect. How do we affect arthritis? Well, arthritis, we can decrease inflammation through things like curcumin. There's another supplement that helps with the immune system, works on a lot of different levels. So curcumin is one of the things we can do to lower it, but I would tell you that at 47, I have much less arthritis than I did when I was 27. And I thought waking up with achy joints and after doing activities was related to, oh, I just have arthritis. I didn't understand, even as a doctor, that arthritis is really connected to inflammation that comes from the GI tract. So when we were, when I'm able to change people's diet and heal their GI tract where it's not letting large particles through that the immune system doesn't recognize, when I clear out bad bacteria and I clear out yeast, then I've healed the gut. And once I heal the gut, a lot of things start clearing up, such as arthritis. So another thing that we see, we really have connected this now, is that cardiovascular disease. Let's talk about that. Coronary artery disease, or the heart. Actually, most of the damage happens within the vessels of the heart within the first hour of eating. They have shown, there's a good paper that shows that a lot of this inflammation, a lot of the damage happens right after eating. So that, once again, shows this connection between the GI tract inflammation and the coronary artery disease. And blaming coronary artery disease on cholesterol is like blaming the hole in the wall on the spackling that was used to repair it. So yes, there are particle sizes in cholesterol that make it much more likely to clog into an inflamed area of the heart. So to develop plaques, you need inflammation. And we know now that inflammation and the source of the inflammation is coming from a lot of times the foods that we're eating. So sugar is one of the big things. If I had to pick the big three things, would be gluten, dairy, and sugar. Sugar is terrible for the GI tract. I would say that feeds a lot of bad bacteria and yeast and creates imbalances or dysbiosis. So this dysbiosis is driven by sugar. And we know that sugar in and of itself creates tons of inflammation because fructose, the part of the sucrose molecule, actually goes to the liver. It's the only place that it can be processed, and it creates inflammatory molecules, creates fatty acids, and creates those small particle cholesterol that get stuck in the vessel wall. So when we look at this, we can see that all diseases that I deal with really kind of connect to this cascade of inflammation that leads to other disease processes. Another disease process that a lot of us don't consider and we think is totally separate is things that are related to the brain, like depression and anxiety. So when someone comes in with the complaint of depression and anxiety, do I say, well, you need an SSRI and then we'll see how that goes? I don't think of it as, that's the analogy that I use all the time. That is selling you a mop for the water on the floor instead of fixing the sink. Where is the depression coming from? And we show, and anxiety, we show that when we have inflammation, these cytokines, interleukin-6, tumor necrosis factor, nuclear factor, kappa B, these things are triggered by inflammation. And the interesting thing about inflammation and the immune system, if it feels like it's under attack, it doesn't care that you are not happy. It wants you to be in a state where you can fight off the infection or the insult. So the less active you are, the better you can use your resources to fight it off. And so depression actually is driven by these cytokines going in and blocking the production of serotonin through an enzyme called IDO. But that IDO enzyme then makes, when it's shut off from making serotonin, then we make something called quinolinic acid, and that causes depression, it causes inflammation, it causes anxiety. So when we look at these seemingly allergies, depression, coronary artery disease, and arthritis, they don't seem connected, but I will tell you that they are. And the reason that they're connected is because of the immune system. And the more we can help our immune system, the better we're going to do in treating all diseases, whatever that disease may be. So getting that immune system working the way it should, where it's not overreacting, we're going to be able to address a lot of the disease processes that are diseases of inflammation. Other things that play a role that a lot of us don't realize are sabotaging our health are things like mold. A lot of us have mold or water damage offices that we work in, schools, and we also have issues with the homes that we live in. So mold is a big one. Mold toxins, mycotoxins, we're not talking about the actual mold, we're talking about the toxins they release. They're very inflammatory, and a lot of my patients, as part of their workup, I fix the GI, but I want to make sure they're not being exposed to mold. I think mold is one of those hidden things we don't talk about a lot in the medical community, and understanding, does my house have mold? Do I have a bathroom that has water damage, and then it's, and then a lot of people have basements where their heaters and their air conditioning units are, and they're recycling these mycotoxins, which are inflammatory molecules by design. Another thing that plays a big role that I've always thought that, okay, when I was at the functional medicine conferences, and they would talk about the need for meditation and working on our stress, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's great, whatever, let's get to the physiology of things. But I have found, the longer I've been in practice, that stress is a huge, huge problem. A lot of people, when they get diseases or get chronic diseases, or they get fibromyalgia, or they get Lyme disease, one of the big triggering factors is a period of intense stress, whether it's the loss of a loved one, a divorce, or another issue. A lot of stress really has been shown to create a sympathetic discharge, which sympathetic is our fight or flight, and it moves us out of parasympathetic. And when we move out of parasympathetic, we move out of that tolerance of our immune system, and we move into a real state of hyperreactive immune system. So working on stress by, and meditation and yoga are two of the best ways to do this. And the reason that it works is because it moves us into a parasympathetic state. So if we can meditate or take 5 deep breaths, we immediately move out of that stress state into that relaxed state, and we move into a parasympathetic state. So it plays a huge, huge role in our immune system. Another thing that is very, very important, and these are, you're basically seeing some of my tenets when the patient first sees me, is to address these, and one of those is sleep. I think sleep is another missing piece of the puzzle when people start looking at diseases, and we tend to, we don't think of sleep as essential, but sleep is probably the most essential body function that we have, and we don't get enough of it. As Americans, we went from an average of 8 hours in the 50s a night, we're less than 6 hours of sleep, and that is really playing a role. And then let's talk about real quick the role of obstructive sleep apnea. And it doesn't mean you need to be overweight to have obstructive sleep apnea. I've got people that are very much in the normal range of their BMI, and their sleep, they have significant sleep apnea. And so that's part of my initial workup is sleep, because obstructive sleep apnea leads to inflammation. And then that inflammation, so if you could look at it as obstructive sleep apnea here, going to inflammation here, and then when you get more inflammation, it increases your obstructive sleep apnea. It's a chicken or the egg. What led to what? And I think the importance is you need to break this cycle by addressing sleep in a lot of people. So if you're not looking at obstructive sleep apnea when you're looking at chronic disease, you're doing a real disservice by trying to understand, by not understanding the role of inflammation and the role that sleep plays in inflammation. So obstructive sleep apnea, sleep, very, very important. Another area that we touched on in last month is toxins. And here we are connecting GI, toxins, and immune. This is how functional medicine works. Everything interconnects. And so toxins, just in and of themselves, let's talk about those toxins. What if you have mercury fillings? We've shown that mercury fillings, and I know a lot of us over the age of 30 tend to have mercury fillings in place of the new polymers they use, and mercury actually creates, actually even after immunizations, you create antibodies to the mercury, the thimerosal that's used, and especially if you're leaking mercury on a daily basis from your tooth, which I know there's a lot of controversy associated with that, but I have found a definite clinical connection of people that have fillings and higher mercury levels. And so if we're not addressing things like mercury, then we really are looking at another reason of why people are having immune dysfunction. So that's another piece I look at. I try to do a challenge test where I actually see what mercury is, not in the blood necessarily, but is hidden in the body that's creating this immune reaction. This is called a hapten, a fancy word for what mercury is, and it causes the immune system to create antibodies and causes disruption. Some other things that are, you know, just the chemicals that we're exposed to each day. That's why it's important to you to decrease our chemical load each and every day, because chemicals take away from our body its ability to detox, and when we have high levels of detox focused on chemicals, then we can't work on making glutathione, which is one of the great detoxers and one of the great anti-inflammatories, antioxidants. So another thing to look at with inflammation is glutathione. So glutathione is being disrupted when we have a lot of toxins. So sugar is another thing, here it comes again, but sugar is a great toxin because it has to be processed in the liver, not glucose. Glucose is different. Glucose is what we have in potatoes and other things. Glucose actually doesn't, over time, cause the insulin resistance that we see with sucrose, because it's the fructose molecule that has to be processed in the liver, and it takes resources away. So sugar is a quite large reason for why we have issues with toxins. So when we look at this, we see that there's a lot of things playing in to why we are developing the diseases. We start with the GI tract, and we start affecting the immune system by changing our diet. We address these different things by keeping it really simple. We eat a healthy diet, a whole foods diet. Some things that were very helpful for managing the immune system, vitamin D. Vitamin D, a lot of literature on vitamin D, and understanding all the ways that vitamin D plays a role is still in the process of being understood. But one of the interesting papers that I read was vitamin D actually plays a huge role in the GI tract, because vitamin D is associated with improving, they showed that the four major bacteria in the gut that create immune health are actually dependent on vitamin D. And vitamin D, when we have vitamin D, our immune system is improved because it helps those bacteria. It also works at a cellular level. It also works, vitamin D works directly on depression and anxiety, but it works, we think, a lot, as in curcumin. Also, it works at a gut level. That's why I think curcumin doesn't necessarily have to be in the form where it passes through the gut and goes directly in the bloodstream, because I think a lot of the curcumin benefit and the vitamin D benefit is happening at the GI level, because that is where I believe 95 to 99% of our immune functions going on. And actually we see, we do more in our gut in one day than the rest of our body does really in a lifetime, because when you look at the small intestine and all the lymphoid tissue there, we're looking at a surface area that's basically the size of a tennis court. And that tennis court has to process a tremendous amount of information and has to make almost split decisions on what's good and bad. So that is how I think these things are playing a role. You can see probiotics, curcumin, vitamin D, these are all things that are very, very important for the gut. Another thing, it's not necessarily a supplement, although you can supplement, we find that the good bacteria or the commensal bacteria in the GI tract, one of the best things for that to create the right growth is fiber. Just good old fiber. And so when we talk about fiber, We're talking about, you know, we always hear eat your whole fruits and whole vegetables because they're full of fiber. The problem with orange juice or apple juice, they have no fiber, and so your body is slammed with fructose, which of course affects our liver. But if you have fiber, it slows that so your body can handle it. But the fiber in and of itself really works to help with GI tract. So your bacteria are dependent upon fiber. That is the fuel for the good bacteria. And you might not necessarily need probiotics as much as you need fiber. So I think fiber plays a huge role in this. And finally, one of the things that I've been doing a lot more research on is the role of zinc. You know, zinc is very inexpensive, and there's a lot of factors is involved in zinc absorption and zinc transport, and there's polymorphisms and other issues, but one of the big inflammatory molecules called interleukin-6 is directly affected by zinc. So why do, you know, I grew up, my mother put me on zinc and vitamin C every time I got a cold, or to prevent a cold in the wintertime, and comes to find out that zinc was a huge immune modulator and actually helped me fight infection without overreacting and having too much inflammation. So I put zinc down here, and then vitamin C is a large player in the immune system as well. We've seen that vitamin C actually, in and of itself, along with glutathione, there was a study that showed that it very much modulated that inflammatory factor and lowered immune overreaction. So to kind of sum up all of this, you can kind of see you work on the basics to affect your immune system. It doesn't have to be complicated. It doesn't require things, immune modulators like Remicade and other things. We know that by healing the gut, and one of the areas that I'm also looking at right now is the role of inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's. And we have found a real connection between Crohn's disease, which is a complete disruption of the immune system in the GI tract, and dysbiosis, or overgrowth of bad bacteria. And when we address the dysbiosis in the GI tract, all of a sudden, diseases like Crohn's get better. And a lot of people say, well, you know, I've got Crohn's or inflammatory bowel disease, ulcerative colitis. There's nothing I can do except be on these medications. If I can do this, and a lot of my patients, if I can change their GI tract, if I can work on their toxins, their sleep, their stress, their mold, then I can affect what seems to be an inevitable disease. And it actually is a lot of Crohn's disease and other things is after a GI infection or a large amount of stress. And another disease that we talk about and that's very much prevalent in my practice is Lyme disease. And a Lyme patient will come into me and say, okay, I have Lyme disease, let's treat it. And I think there may be some frustration in my approach because I'm first like, I don't say let's start antibiotics. I go back, and the reason I go back is because I've got to first work on toxins, I've got to work on sleep, I've got to work on stress, I've got to make sure there's no mold, and above all, I've got to heal their GI tract, because the immune system needs to move out of a chronic inflammatory state before it can move into a state where it can actually fight infection. So if we don't address the basics of all disease first, then we can't go after these seemingly diseases like Lyme that we want to simplify and say, oh, we just need to put them on antibiotics, and we don't see a lot of people get better just with antibiotics because these things are not being addressed. So when we talk about the immune system, it's a great thing. It's supposed to be there. When it's functioning well, we have health. When it's dysfunctioning, we have disease. And so we really want to do these things here to support health by supporting our GI tract, meditating, getting enough sleep, making sure we're decreasing our toxin exposure, make sure that we're giving the liver what it needs to make glutathione to decrease our oxidative status. And we want to make sure our homes or our work environments are free of mold. And if they're not free of mold, there's things we can do to bind it, like chlorella, to help lower that toxin burden. So I appreciate your time this morning as I gave you a very, very broad view of the immune system. This is not by any means super specific, because it would take me hundreds of hours to really go into the immune system, and I'm still learning all the nuances of the immune system. But I'll tell you that with very broad strokes, we can make big changes in our immune system and big changes in our health. And so I hope this has been helpful. Thank you.